appreciate everybody having me out here. My name is B. Taylor. Little bit about me. I'm in music now. I was discovered by the Motown legends. I was discovered by Pete Moore, Smokey Robinson, Automotive, Mr. Gordy, about 8 years ago. They named me the Stevie Wonder of hip hop. And I was an ex-Navy, served in the military, and the Pentagon ended up making, I'm a global ambassador of music and entertainment and advocate for the United States military veterans, first responders, and their families. So it's never happened like that, you know, so it's a different tip in the music business. But a little background, I'm from Peoria, Illinois. Grew up playing sports, football, basketball, went to the University of Missouri, played football, basketball, got recruited, took a scholarship, and decided to transfer, you know, throughout my sophomore year, go to Florida, Florida State. They didn't transfer, I was going to go there, and they didn't transfer. It was an NCAA clearinghouse. So I was down and out, man, like, you know, grew up in, my dad's a reverend, grew up in church, you know, playing instruments. So I'm thinking, okay, I'm trying to transfer. You know, I got a chance of going further in NFL or NBA for sports. So they didn't give me that. So I decided to go to the recruiting station to get ROTC. And I know y'all aware of that. So, I figured, okay, I'll go ROTC. They told me I could continue to play ball and finish out my career as a engineer as well and play ball. I didn't get that. It ended up going active duty. They messed that up. So, you know, I'm in active duty, you know, getting ready to go to the military and go to the Navy. My dad told me one thing. My pops was like, don't say nothing. Just keep your mouth shut and just finish at the top and it all pan out and work out. You just got a different detour. God got you going on. It is what it is. So I listened to him and go in there. And about 6 weeks in, you know, I was over my division. It was 120 guys. It was guys from different walks of life. You know, I'm coming from playing college ball to going to boot camp. So it's a big switch, a big different, you know. But I was over the unit. You had guys from Compton, bunking with cats from Alaska that never seen black. It was just a whole different experience than even in a ball team because you had guys from really, really different backgrounds. And so week six in, the higher-ups, my unit, RDCs, which is your recruit command guys, they were like, hey, we found out you play ball and you didn't say nothing in here. I was like, nah, you know, my pops told me to be quiet and they let everybody know, you know, that I played. And so I ended up meeting the higher-ups, the captain, the commanding officer. And they was like, look, son, we found out you were playing ball and do you want to go to the Naval Academy? And I was like, well, how many years do you have to give? Can I think about that first? They were like, okay, fine. So you're going to be stationed out in San, and you're going to go to Florida for your training and your school and everything with Marines. And, you know, we're going to let the command out there and the commanding officer know about it. So I get out there. I finish top in my school out there in the training and everything. And I end up meeting the commanding officer. And they said, look, the Secretary of the Navy and the Chief of Naval Operations, who's the highest ranking officer in the Navy, they're coming and you're going to give a tour at a school. And so I'm touring, you know, with Secret Service. You know, here I'm, you know, it's just a wild experience. I'm touring with Secret Service and different people and walking around in school. And the Secretary of the Navy is like, look, I want you to play this basketball game with us today. And he was a big basketball fan and you're going to guard me. So game point comes up, I block his shot. And there, you know, Secret Service, the Navy was like, man, you got to let the Sec Nav, you know, score. You can't be blocking his shot. He was like, nah, he's a competitor. This is what makes the Navy. He said, son, where do you want to go to school? You want to go to the Naval Academy? What do you want to do? We heard about your situation. I was like, well, that's so many years, sir. But, you know, if I could, you know, do my rate and serve and, you know, if I play on the All-Navy basketball team or All-Navy sports and still serve and go to the NFL, can you line me up? He said, well, do you want to go to San Diego, Chicago, or Jacksonville? Because that's where NFL teams are. So which one? I was like, you know, I've never been on the West Coast like that. So I came from Illinois. You know, I went to San Diego. I'm out in San Diego, then the war is going on, right? So I play on the All-Navy Team USA, but I got caught. I had a critical rating, and so got called out. But then they pulled me back. After seeing a lot, they pulled me back. And they was like, look, we're going to put you on these TAD orders, which is special duty, temporary assignment duties. So it was like, you're going to go here on the base, and then you'll be able to work out with the NFL. So all this time, I'm working, man, the NFL. I had two cats that played college with me that was playing for the Chargers, and one was playing for the Raiders. So on a weekend, they asked me to go to L.A. You know, I'm in the Navy. You know, I've been around athletes, but I hadn't been around professional, the level of professional. So they asked me to go up to L.A., I go to LA, man, and I took my buddy from the Navy. We go to this celebrity event, right? And we playing. It's a celebrity event, and I'm playing the piano because the piano player gets sick. So I'm playing the piano. I play Ribbon in the Sky. And my buddies was being funny. They was like, you know, I was playing in the back, and actually someone heard it. And they was like, B can play it. And they was like, kid, can you play Ribbon? I was like, yeah, because I play four instruments. So I play Ribbon in the Sky. They get done. They announce me as being in the Navy, that I was working out with the Chargers, getting ready to go to the NFL. Dude comes up to me at the end with big hair. He's like, look, man, my brother famous. My mom is in the back, and his famous friends, they want to meet you. Man, I kid y'all now. I walk around. Man, it was Snoop, Nate Dogg, like everybody I grew up to just sitting there, and Snoop mom. And Snoop was like, yo, man, you know, he was like, what's your name? I was like, B. They call me BT for sure. He's like, all right, look, B-Tizzle. He was like, look, man, this Ribbon in the Sky is my mom's favorite song. Can you play at her birthday and her wedding? I was like, yo, like, I'm in the Navy, Snoop. I'm about to go to the NFL. He's like, look, I'll handle it. And it was Nate Dogg sitting there. It was M. It was just like the whole clique was just sitting there. Eastsiders. I know y'all remember some of these. This is all these cats were sitting here. So I'm like, oh, man, really? So I get back. I took all these pictures. So I get back to the base. You know, you got in the Navy, you don't just come back with pictures of, like, the whole West Coast, you know what I mean, Raps and Snoop. So they call my command. I play at the birthday party. I play at the wedding. Snoop takes me, and they invite me to his birthday. Uncle Junebug. I don't know if y'all remember the one that died. He'd be dancing all over the place, Uncle Junebug. They take me to his birthday. So me and my buddy, he told me, bring a couple Navy boys. So, you know, you serving in the military. It's like, yo, we about to go up to Snoop's house for a birthday party. So we get to the house. Okay, go to the birthday party. Packed, having a good time. Bing, which is Snoop's brother that just brought me to him, he was like, you know what, tomorrow come and let B bring some music. Now, at the same time, I had like a keyboard back in center, because I would just do music for fun while I was in Navy still doing my football. So I had a keyboard and I had like the computer, and I thought, you know, it was hooked up, and I thought, like, you know, I'm about to go take these beats up and Snoop. I'm about to get this, like, this is my chance. I'm in football, but I'm about to make something come out of this music thing, too. So we go the next day. They all in the studio. It's Master P. It was Eastsider, Nate Dogg, Superfly, Daz, Corrupt. I can go down the whole list. Everybody was in the studio. So Bing goes up. He was like, Snoop, can B play this music? Because we was playing, getting ready to play a basketball. Snoop had a basketball game. So we was going to play basketball. So Snoop, they was like, can he play some music? So I go in there, I'm thinking, I'm all excited. My two Navy buddies, Snoop, like, yeah, put it on real quick. Cause he was playing some stuff like woom, woom with that Dre, you know, and stuff. So they turned the music off, put mine up. Man, my stuff came up, it turned, it was loud, it was like, you know what I mean? It went from woom to soft. Snoop was like, cut that shit off. He said, nephew, what you doing? He said, don't you ever play nothing like this when you got an opportunity to be here. What you need to do, get with Superfly, get with them over here, get with Fred Rec, get with these cats right here. Right, they're going to tell you what to get. Go take that Navy money if you get that ball money and get this. So it was an embarrassing moment for me because it was like more than this many people in the thing, you know. He cut it off. And then he was like, engineer, turn my Dre stuff back on. And Dre just sent me this new stuff, and Pharrell sent me, which was the beautiful. They was playing that up in the – so – he played that. He said, this is how this stuff's supposed to sound. So, you know, that was a moment check. So I didn't get mad. So I took it back. I'm like, man, let me go back to San Diego. I had my Navy thing. I went and got exactly what the list was. And he told me I needed to work that and master that and don't never be in the atmosphere to do that. So it came to where I had to choose. So Snoop was like, we're going to set you. Bing was like, we're going to set you up with a studio, San Diego. So I go to San Diego. Next door to me in the studio, Blink 182, Green Day, they was Jimmy Eat World, they was going to Pop Disaster Tour. They came in and asked me, they heard about me in here, could they hear me play? So I was in there making some music that Snoop Nim had set me up studio with, his brother did. They said, man, we want you to play the keys on the Pop Disaster Tour. So again, I took this back to the command, and they was like, what? So I came on a couple dates of that and became friends in that world. And so then it came time where I had to choose between the league and music. So I was in San Diego, the Coors Amphitheater. Never forget this. I went to go see M. You know what I mean? Because they hooked it up to go see him, and I went to see him. And so Proof, I don't know if y'all remember D12, Proof passed away. So Proof, You know, proof was, they was standing. One of these guys, the security firstborn, was standing. He was like, man, you look familiar. I was like, yeah, man, Snoop. Y'all met me through Snoop a year ago, whatever. He's like, come, and I was going into football. He was like, come on, come real quick. Man, I went on the backstage, went on tour bus. Proof was like, look, dude, you're going to come to Detroit. I'm going to work with you. You talented. I was like, Proof, I got football, though. You know what I mean? I'm still in the Navy getting ready to get out and go to NFL. I'm like, man, I got football. He was like, look, you're going to come. You're going to work on this thing. When we do this D12 album, I'm going to put you on, but you got to show me what you can do. So I was in the middle. So I got out the Navy. They let Earl me out. I was still getting ready for football. I went to Detroit. I was working on the stuff in Detroit. And everything, Proof was showing. He's like, look, you keep coming to the studio. I was having a work ethic, you know what I mean? Because he would give me the keys to go to their studio. He had a label called Iron Fist that was part of D12 and Shady. So I was going to it, and then all of a sudden, man, the night he came to me, he was like, look, I'm going on the east side. I was like, Proof, I don't really be on that, man. Like, I'm about the studio. Let me stay at the hotel, and I'm not going to go, but I'll see you in the morning. That was the night he got killed. And so I was sitting there like, I came from this to go into music. I'm like, okay, football. I'm like, now what? I can't go to music. You know what I mean? I just made my decision not to do football. I can't. Proof was my, I know everybody, but Proof was, he was leading me in to go this way. And he had me set up going to Interscope. So I'm like, man, what the heck? So I done chose not football. I'm in music. So I did this. So my parents moved out here. My dad, I don't know if y'all heard of Victory Baptist Church. Out here, it's like the largest church. It's about for 13, 14. Dr. Fowler, my dad, Reverend Taylor, that's my father. So he was moved out here. I hadn't been out here yet. So I come out here. My dad was like, man, just make your decision. You still got, go get ready for the next year of football. Music not going to go. Just get yourself right. You still got aid. You can get agents. And I was down because Proof was really, and Firstborn was really guiding me, man. They really took me in, you know, along with Snoop's brother Bing to really see what I had going on. And, you know, and so I didn't know what to do. So I'm out here. I get a condo on Ann Road. Wasn't living out here, Ann Road, at the Painted Desert Golf Resort. I know y'all know where that's at, on the 95 and Ann. So I get a condo. I still was living in San Diego, but I get a condo. I'm moving into the condo. I had a couple people from Detroit that was visiting, and I moved. So I come out, and it's this old condo. It's like 55 years and older. The condo is, you couldn't even get in it, but I was able to get in it because of the football and the connections I had to get in it. So I moved in. I'm playing the piano at night, and I was just playing at night. Come down the next morning. My neighbor, he's older. He said, he called me Billy. He'd be like, Billy, I know you just been here a day, but I heard you playing the music, and it soothes my wife. She has cancer. It soothes her at night. What are you doing now? I'm like, man, I'm trying to get ready for football. I just got this, and I'm going to come back and forth. But I was in music, and he was like, speaking of music, there's a Motown legend that lives in here. He was one of the founding members of Motown, and he never comes this way, but we see him. And he was like, my wife waves to his wife, and he was like, honey, what's the name? And the name, he said, I don't know. And then this gas guy pulls up. He was like, yo, there's this car from Michigan, Detroit. Who's from Michigan? And the gas guy, I was like, oh, I got a couple friends from Detroit here. I just moved here yesterday. They're going back. The gas guy was like, I'm from Detroit. Then my neighbor was like, yeah, all this Motown here. What's his name? And he said, honey, oh, his name is Pete Moore. Soon as he said that, y'all, I kid y'all not, a gray Mercedes. He never went this way. In the 20 years he's been out here, gray Mercedes came like this. And then my neighbor said, that's him. He never went that way after he said his name. I ran up to the door. He rolled the window down. I'm with my neighbor. He was on a cigar. He was like, how you doing, son? Can I help you? I said, Mr. Moore, I know you don't know who I am, but I know y'all with Smokey and the Miracles. Y'all was the first group of Motown, started Motown. I mean, I did a little music, but I mean, was in football. He said, kid, no more. You came and had the audacity to come up to my car with this person. He said, 45 minutes, here's the number to my assistant, gonna let you in my house. I live through the gates back in here, get your music. Man, I ran in the house. I'm getting stuff together. My two friends that was in from Detroit, like, what'd you? I said, dog, I just met one of the founding members of the Miracles of Motown. He was like, get the heck out of here. I was like, nah, man, I'm going over here in 45 minutes. Dog, I get over there, they let me in. I go into a room, it's about a little bit as big as this, about half, like all of this, okay? All awards that you could think of, Sinatra, Nat King Cole, Ali, I'm talking Michael, like all the way from current Rolling Stones best songs, Grammys, all kind of stuff, World Music Awards, everything you can think of. I'm not talking about, yo, I got a hit record. I'm talking about all the legends, current, you know, Billboard, this, all these things set up. And I'm like, man, and I'm going back, I'm looking at here, like, this is timeless, like from the beginning to all the way down, you know. He said, kid, what you got? I said, I got two. He said, sit down. I said, I got two songs. I got two CDs, one that I produce as me as an artist and other as me a producer and other people singing. He said, let me hear the one with you on everything on it. Y'all, he played two records for 45 seconds. Okay, he went to the first for 30 seconds. He played the first one, 30 seconds. Played the second one, 30 seconds. Was quiet. I was like, dog, you know, I thought it was done. Again, because, you know, somebody played 30 seconds, they go to the next one. Y'all been in ARMEs. They flip through. It's like pretty much they ain't feeling it or whatever. He was like, man, who did? He said, you did everything. He said, play the piano for me. And I got on there. I started playing. He said, play this. He had like another thing, an organ. He said, play that for me. I played. He said, you play what? I said, I play four instruments, Mr. Moore. He said, get your manager on the phone. You what we've been looking for. We about to take you in. We've never worked with a hip-hop artist. You my swan song, and I'm about to take you to the family of Motown. Man, I get on the phone, call my agent, my manager at the time, who still's my manager. I called from a block number. I had been there one day. I want y'all to know I was there to Vegas for 24 hours, y'all. And I was one day. I'm getting on the phone. My manager, Sam, he's a Wall Street guy, right? He picks up. He's like, what number you come from? I'm like, Sam, I'm in the house of Pete Moore, Smokey and the Miracles. He want to take me into Motown and be the first hip-hop artist. He was like, man, you know, Kirk, get the F out of here. You ain't been. Sam, this is Pete Moore. After the holidays, get the contracts together. This is the kid. We're going to take him in, right? Changed my life. So I'm thinking, okay, dang, I just came from here. So I get in touch with the Pentagon in the Navy office. So the Navy was like, okay, this is a story we got to use. So they took it up. The Pentagon was like, this guy just came out of the military going toward the NFL, met all these people in music while in the Navy, and then went and met the Motown legends. It was like some craziness was going on. So the Pentagon was like, look, we're going to allow you to do whatever as long as you're representing us away and allow you to film videos and do whatever at the Pentagon. And so Mr. Moore said, look, son, they're not going to get what you're doing. You a hip-hop artist, play four instruments. The industry not going to get you with classic Motown, bridging the gap with hip-hop pop, and you got the Department of Defense, the U.S. military. The A&Rs in the industry not going to get it. But when the dust lines up and when everybody's, they're going to line up like soldiers. We've been here before when we created Motown. So they took me in the studio, man, 8 months recording Mr. Moore. Like, come down to my house. He made me come to San Diego for 6 months. Come down to my house. He was at my house every day at 5 o'clock with his driver on the dot. He would come in the house for an hour. Let me see what you got. What'd you create today? We would go to the studio. We'd get up at 6 o'clock on the dot, be at the studio. The driver would take us at 6:30. We'd be at the studio 6:30 here in Vegas to freaking 6 a.m. I want y'all to know this is a 70-year-old man. Like, okay, not like a young cat. He was like, I don't want no girlfriends. I don't want no homies. I don't want nobody that ain't got nothing to do with music in here. Because how many records have they wrote? None, Mr. Moore. How many hits they got? None. How many Grammys they got? None. What label did they start? None. All this stuff. Who have they discovered? Had they discovered Stevie? Had they discovered Michael Jackson? He was going down the list. So I don't want nobody coming in here going to tell me how to write a song. You better be here. And we did that for 6 months. And he would bring the different legends in, B.B. King, you know, Aretha, all these different, Mary Wilson of Supremes. They would all come in and be checking, and they would give me the Motown history. So it was like boot camp, y'all. It wasn't like, you know, like I signed to Drake or I signed to Wayne. This was like historical, like a camp. Like, if you're going to be great, this is what we're going to have you do, because this is the lineage. You the last in the Motown lineage. There ain't no more. We not touching nobody else. So this is it. So this is all these artists that's came. Marvin Gaye, the Vandellas, the Temptations, the Four Tops, the, you know, Earth, Wind & Fire, Cuba Getting the Main Ingredient, all these cats. He was going down. Rick James, just all the Michael Jackson, Janet, the Jacksons. And he said, this is the lineage you in. So listen. So what we gonna do? You're not gonna understand it. I know you like your boom boom music, but I'm about to give you the history and the basics. So we got done recording. I was like, man, these guys are serious. You know what I mean? It was serious being an artist with that. So we got done. My managers start coming in. We get ready to take it to the market and stuff. We go into A&Rs. So what, before I went to the label, Mr. Moore did a pre-promotion on the story of what we was doing. So he sent me to places with people, and I was going to different cities, performing, meeting, getting the story, building up the package, and all these like first things was coming, like B. Taylor. I'm appearing in Detroit in the oldest jazz lounge in America, that all these people are the first rapper to perform there. Steve Wynn has me. Mr. Moore goes to the nightclub with my management. This 70-year-old man goes to the nightclub at the Wynn with my management. Pulls up sitting like this with Mr. Wynn, okay? Like, I ain't ever met Mr. Wynn like this. Mr. Wynn said, Mr. Moore, I'm standing right here. We standing right here at this table in the club. Then he reached over. He said, Mr. Moore, I want him to get up on the bar and perform. Mr. Moore said, hey, Steve wants you to get on the bar and perform. I was like, I was looking because I had one person with me, a security person, a couple of people. I'm like, well, I mean, I'm performing, but what am I going to do? Where the mic? Don't worry about that. I'm Steve Wynn. That's exactly what he said. Dog, I got up. They put me up on the thing. I'm performing. Introduced the Motown. I just saw the scene, the power of Motown. You can't just go in and get Mr. Wynn and be like, look, this is what it is. It was like they was on some different levels. And I got up there, performed at Blush Nightclub, running around. Sean Christie let me perform. It was like people looking like, what the hell? Because nobody had performed with a mic at the Wynn on stuff like this. So, you know, I was getting my career was stacking in a different type of way. And so it was going like this. And so it's still, when we went, so we got built it up, went into these A&Rs, went to Universal, went to Warner, went to, I had a packet like this big. They start going through it. They seen my college education with my degrees and stuff. They seen all this stuff with sports. They seen all this first time stuff. They seen this package put together by Wall Street Management, Motown Legends Story. They looking at me, I'm playing music. They looking at me like, dude, what you want us to do with this dude? This dude got a Lifetime Achievement Award already. Mr. Moore and my manager, Wall Street, they're like, let's sign him. We do a joint venture. We already got him at Motown. Just put him out. Just put the story out. It's going to resonate. This is Motown. But you had people in the A&R, we was over them. They couldn't see stuff because you got to be, when you, some of these A&Rs, like you might be talented as heck, but they'll look at you and say, no, you talented. And be like, okay, here my card. I get back with you. Won't move on it. Won't move. And then they don't understand where you're trying to go. So they didn't want, we went to each one. Didn't do nothing. I'm sitting here like Mr. Moore said, I told you, when the dust clear, you stay on the course, they're going to line up. All of a sudden, we had a thing, event. Mr. Moore sitting there, Ray J standing next to, right? He hadn't had a record or whatever. I'm going in the thing, start working on, and then it was, and Detail was there. So his Sexy Can I record. So Ray got, I got introduced by Motown to Ray. Went in there. Then did a buzz record with Ray, and it started building me up. Then the military walked me in, so I started meeting everybody. And then Ray had For the Love of Ray J going on at the time. So then I was in that, and then we performed on MTV. So it started building me up, and that's what the legends were saying. Your peers gonna start getting a whiff. So then it started moving slowly like that. Then I went on and I started meeting other different people. Then the Navy took me off. Y'all ever seen the show NCIS? It come on, it's been on for like ever. The chick plays Abby. She got the pigtails with the freaking big gulp. And okay, I go on set. The military take me on the NCIS set with my manager, introduced me to Pauly because she was a singer with Interscope on a group called Lowball before she was on television winning Emmys. So I go in, she's like, B, I heard your, I sit up, meet the cast, we hanging out. She's like, man, I heard your story. I heard your music. Can we go to church tomorrow? Because we're going to do a record. I was like, you want to do a record? For real? So I go to church with her the next day, and we playing on the piano, messing around. She said, let's do a record. Man, the next day, I recorded the record. I went in myself and recorded Fire and Ice, got it to her singing. She's like, oh, my God, let's call Paramount. I'm at CBS Paramount in 2 days. We just moving, my management moving. We record the record. 2 weeks later, it goes out. They send a press release. Man, my publicist, it was the most downloaded press release story because there was a press release that went out 5 years ago when it was, or 4 years ago when it was, when they, Britney Spears, Rihanna, and Madonna was coming together to do a collab, right? So that press release went out. It was the most downloaded. All of a sudden, I went from this to this record moving, doing this radio promoter with the number one cute actress on TV, right? And then doing all this stuff. Then we doing Extra with Mario Lopez. Entertainment Tonight. It's just how your career just be crazy. The Entertainment Tonight. Then it start moving me. Then President of, this was crazy. Then the Bush family contacts the Navy to me and said, look, this President Bush family on the commission of his ship, his daughter's getting a library, the first library on an aircraft carrier. Can B. Taylor come perform? My management's like, who's he performing with? It's just him and Lone Star. That's a country band. They had like 15 number ones. It was a country artist and me. I go for the Bush family and President Bush family, 10,000 troops and family member performing. And they got up there and said it. They said, well, we don't really, you know, listen to hip hop, but we got something different. But remember, I told y'all, this is what Mr. Moore told me years before what was going to be happening if I stayed the course. Stuff, because they legends. They can see it before it even comes. And then I did that. Then right at the week after, oh, but he's coming out of office. The Navy was like, look, we want you to do the 100th anniversary with the Naval Orchestra, and we're going to perform for the 100th anniversary. We never had a hip-hop artist ever do this with the orchestra. I go perform it. I was nervous as heck, y'all, because it was 5,000 Congress and their family and dignitaries, and, you know, you going up rapping with an orchestra at the White, you know, in D.C., it's different. I went up there, did my song, One Life, did it. They got done, the SecNav came to me, they was all the higher-ups in the back with shaking hands. Keep going, you represent us. The next day, you guys, I get a call on the phone. The call on the phone, the advisor to the Pentagon was like, get your managers, all of them on the phone. The admiral was calling you, the chief of information from the Pentagon Public Affairs is calling you, they got something for you. Call me the next day, they was like, hey, B, Congress was so impressed for you, what you did. We got the aircraft. I don't know if y'all remember this. It was 11-11-11. It was the first basketball game on an aircraft carrier. North Carolina and Michigan State. It was on ESPN. It was all. So it was quick, and they called. The airman was like, look, they were so impressed. They got it to Obama. Obama wants you to do the Star Spangled Banner. Now, I ain't even a singer. He wants you to do the Star Spangled Banner, and then you're going to play in a halftime game. I'm like, what? Yeah, you're going to meet the president on Air Force One. You're going to do this to get with Mr. and Mrs. Michelle Obama. Like, nobody had performed for me. I was like, what? I don't sing. Well, you better figure out how to sing, because they was impressed. So I get my mom singing in church. So I'm playing keys. I'm rehearsing. I hold a note, but I'm not a singer like that for when you're trying to do in front of 100 million people, because the president, it was the aircraft carrier that buried Osama bin Laden's ashes, and then he was going to give his annual address. That's not the cup of tea you want to be playing around when the whole world is watching. So I got ready, did it, was practicing, went and did Extra again with Mario Lopez. He covering it, and then I do perform it, man. Nervous as heck, man. I was sweating before they called, coming from Air Force One. It was just the most chilling thing, and I nailed it. Had a good day that day. Took my career to where it was like, dang, everybody start paying attention in the industry going, what the heck? And I just start my management team start leveraging and then taking me into NASCAR, because I had a different brand. It was like, here's this, he's a global ambassador, he's an advocate, here's his videos with the military, here's his Pentagon, here's his music. Then it was like NASCAR, went over here. Then I'm doing stuff, performing at congressional stuff. I'm doing stuff, and you know, I speak to kids across the country. I've spoken to over 175,000 kids, so I visit kids and speak, and I visit troops. That's part of my ambassador role around my music. So I'm doing all this stuff, and stuff just going like this. And then now we come to now, I'm working on all these different records and working with people, you know, friends with this person, with this person. Then I get that call to where, you know, I got this new record. Now I'm up to now to where I get a call. I take a guy I knew for a long time, Jamal. Puffy, Diddy, and Mark Wahlberg had this Aqua Hydrate water. And this water, I don't know if y'all seen it. He did his Fiji commercial, then the Fiat commercial with the Aqua Hydrate. That's Puff and Mark Wahlberg on it. So I've been on the water for like 4 years. I knew Jamal, the business partner for Mark Wahlberg, Floyd, and all them. And Jamal been following me, been like a brother. He was like, I was like, Jamal, I called him. I said, look, Obama's going off of office. You want to go meet Obama? He was like, dude, if I go meet President Obama, Puff and Mark and Floyd, they're going to be tripping. Like, how in the heck are we going? I said, come on, man. I took Ray J. Then we go meet the president. I get, you know what I mean? I'll get it done. All right. We go. The next day he comes. Obama put his hand talking like this. standing, like, talking to this dude like this. I take the picture. I'm just standing, taking a picture. Send it to him. He sent it to Puff and everything. Man, his likes, his phone was like going crazy. He was like, man, who in the heck took you to get that close to put your arms where Obama put his arms on you, where you can have a car? He's like, dude, it's this dude, B. Taylor. We told you he's got this unique. Next day, Puffy's vice president, Erica Pittman, y'all can look her up. She's the vice president of Comb Enterprises, black lady. Handles all the CEOs of his entities, Bad Boy, Sean John, Ciroc, his flaming agency, 3 a.m. Cologne, all Puffy's stuff. The CEOs, they report to Erica. She's the right hand. She goes, hey, B, we saw what you're doing. We want to put a program together with you called Under Your One Life with our Aquahydrate called the One Life Aquahydrate Military Program. Can you make this happen at the Pentagon? I was like, let's go. All of a sudden, 2-3 months, I've been knowing, I said, let's go. So then New Year's Eve came. Puff, they had me set up for his New Year's Eve thing. It was everybody you can imagine at this thing. They had a New Year's Eve after hours, after 4, and the only way you can be in it if you was a real artist and your manager. That was it. It wasn't even for regular people, man. And went up in there, everybody was in there. And Puff gave me down. He's like, man, you on some other stuff. That's what he said to me. He's like, you on B. Taylor, you on some other stuff, some other stuff. I was like, what you mean? He said, don't let nobody change this brand. Everybody tell you it's corn, whatever you want. You define the whole game. You like over here, but get with Erica because we're excited. Get with Erica, set the meeting up with the Pentagon, with all the exchanges. And I said, Erica, and I helped them develop this new One Life Fit Family, First Family program that they're going to choose the first fit family of each branches, why they're fit, and give them a year of Aquahydrate, paid Disney trip for the Disney. They're going to get my new headphones that I have with Boost Mobile. They're going to get all these perks of being a fit family. And it's a whole national campaign with me, Mark Wahlberg, Diddy, and Julian Michaels, right? And I'm thinking to myself, and I'm telling y'all this because these legends told me this back here, way back here 8 years ago. And all of a sudden, I didn't know what my team, we was fighting with my new brand, alienating. Like, what the heck is wrong with me? Why'd I come in so high? I came in so big with Motown and the DOD, nobody get it. And then the thing I remember, the legends told me when we were sitting here, they said, when your peers that's in the industry start dealing with you, it's gonna be on a whole nother level. Now I done had the dude of the industry, Puffy's number one on Forbes, not like down here done it, came to me to do a program that he couldn't put together. And just all this stuff started coming together of what these legends said to me. So what I'm telling y'all is, y'all, I go all the way back, enough about me. Y'all got two guys in here, man. They don't charge. They do it from their heart. They gave y'all the, like, trophies, go out their ways. To give. Don't nobody run like this in the industry. I'm telling y'all straight up, it don't go like this. That's the Motown way. This way like this, this is what those legends did. They put you to work for like before they sign you. They put it to see what your, I don't care if you got 2 jobs, 5 jobs, you show up over here because they don't do nothing to you. They say, look, you want to come in here? You want to be successful? I'm going to teach you how to be this. Go to your work and then you go do your music and stuff. And these guys is like that. I see the way they got it set up, doing videos, doing music, let you come in here. Anytime they're here to hone your craft, man, ain't nobody doing that like that unless they really signing you and you money is going somewhere. Somebody's getting papered somewhere. It's not just like, yo, come into this and do this. They do this, man. And that's the Motown way. And I'm telling y'all, if y'all want to be in this because this business is, like, for real, this is a real business, you got, it be times, man, they'll take some, you know, like, he tight as heck, right? And he come in and he rap, and it's a group, and everybody know he tight. Then he leave out the room, cats a black ball, and be like, man, don't sign him. Don't sign him. Man, my homeboy over here. And they know he tight. Don't sign them. Be all in your face when you in there and you doing it. They're like, oh, he hot. That's hot. You leave out the door, don't sign them. Don't sign them. I got my homeboy, man, over here. You been waiting and waiting. Nah, man, don't sign them. Then he wondering what they said they was going to call me back. This is the industry you go. You got girlfriends. You go meeting people. right? You going in the studio, it's all good. You going in there to meet this celebrity, you taking it, your a girl that you know, you better take your girlfriend that's your girlfriend. Don't take a girl you just met. Because you start taking them in the studio with celebs, you don't know that girl? I've seen it. You go up in there, but the next day, you don't see her no more. All of a sudden, you see her at the BET Awards on TV, like, what? She ain't calling me no more. I'm telling you, this is the game of the game. Stuff be messed up like that. So if you going in there work on records, go by yourself unless it's your girl, your wife. You know what I'm saying? And let it be known, oh, this is my girlfriend, this is my wife. It's like that. But if you taking a new person that don't got your back and she's sitting in Drake over there, hang it up. If Drake come holler and she ain't real, hang it up. I'm telling you, Drake gonna be chilling. I'm telling y'all real, this is me talking real stuff to y'all because these guys are setting this up. This is how this industry did. Come again. You think you come in A&R, they say make this hit. You make the record, they say change it. You don't change it in the fashion time. Now you ain't off the publishing. Now you off the label. They ain't even, you like, man, I just talk. No, this person said this. Or if they make a switch, you better get in that office and meet who the new switch is. So if you've been dealing with this A&R beast right here, he gets moved out the way and he come, you better get your butt over there because if he get his claws into who he want and whatever and you ain't tight with him, now you over here left field. But you was like, I was dealing with beast. Well, I'm not beast. This is how this game moves so fast like this, y'all. It moves because it's so much money that moves and stuff and side deals and people using deals. So what I'm saying to you guys is learn this stuff in here. This is the place to learn, and this is like a family environment. These guys is like family environment. Come in here and be on your grind. Get ready for this stuff because I'm telling you, I got a crazy schedule. You know what I'm saying? I got to be moving around. Luke would tell you, your guys would tell you I had Secret Service on me. Like, I don't like moving around with that stuff, but that's the thing that comes with this stuff. So you give up your freedoms, okay? You give up, you can't go. Like, last night I had a concert. It was me, Ray J, Tiger Lights. I get there, I couldn't hardly talk to them. I couldn't even hardly talk to them because when you get there and you focal, it's like everybody in your face. So if you're not used to dealing with this stuff, this business is not for you because it's like a switch. It's like you switch. You go from not moving to meeting some people on TV. Then you get DMs. You're getting Facebook hits from cats in high school, grade school, cousins coming out the woodworks asking you for money. Can you pay for their house? I'm telling y'all, you probably get it already now. Go get a big record. Go get on TV. They coming. I had people said I changed because I wouldn't donate to their freaking thing. I didn't even know. One guy hit me out the Navy. He said, told my publicist to have mercy on his soul. This ain't the same B. Taylor we knew in the Navy because I wouldn't give him money for his child that passed away for cancer. It's like, man, you know how many people hit for money? I didn't even know. And it's not like I changed. It's just this is the stuff that happens. This is how people be changing, thinking you change because you got an opportunity and you can't help everybody and you got to move a certain way. So now you didn't change. These are all these things you got to think about, man, when you going in this business. And the urban, we in the hip hop. It's the most effed up game in the planet, y'all. It's the most lucrative, like the legends told me, it's the most lucrative, biggest branding, most money, effed up business in the world. There are no rules, okay? When you go into the country world got their rules. If you notice, you see all the country artists, if they got beef, whatever, but they all help, they all together. Then you got all the white pop artists, they all be together, it's cool. But when it come to us, man, we can't, if we ain't in a certain clique, it's like, if you know Beast is tight, push Beast. If you know he's tight, push him. If he's tight, push him. You know why? Because we all go. That's what happens. If one goes and you support him and you know your turn and your thing, just get somebody there, support him. Don't try to undercut him if he's the one in front. That's what we do, hip hop. We get somebody there, then we try to undercut. No, let him shine. Because if you be the one to help him shine, that's the value of you. So when it comes your time, you step in the game. That's the value. This is how the game is. That's what I did. I paid my dues. I was quiet when when I was with everybody, I didn't say nothing. And then when it came time for me to play, everybody's like, dang, he do this. I didn't come in there because you took me, say you took me to Flo Rida. I come in there trying to be all loud. I need to sit down. Flo's your man. And then when the time come for me, Flo gonna hear it. If you cool and y'all cool, and he be like, Flo be like, man, yeah, you can bring him all the time. He cool. But if you come in there all loud and you in the way, it's like, man, why you bring that dude? Don't bring that dude no more. Then you out the game. But that's what we do. We try to undercut. Just get push whoever the talent is, who got the talent to go. The family push that dude because he puts everyone on. But when you're pushing him, don't be undercutting. Wait your time. Your time, we all got times. Wait your time. Don't try to undercut somebody because they got the opportunity. God meant for them to go. And that meant for everyone to go. It's like a caboose. That's what the legends taught me. Smokey made it clear. He said, look, I wrote the song Smile. The Miracles, we did Smile. Mr. Moore told me all the time. Tracks of My Tears. They wrote this. It was a big record. But then, and they did Smile. But then Michael came. Michael did it, and it went like, boom. Y'all know Smile. Michael did. That joker was huge. Then they did Tracks of My Tears. Bonnie Pratt, or whatever her name is, she did Tracks of My Tears, Country World. 15 million. But you know what the legend said? We don't care because we the originators. Michael sing that song. Yeah, we was big with our million. Michael made 30 million, but we the originators. That shows how great we are. You know what I'm saying? Bonnie Pratt singing for the country. We're the originators getting paid. That shows you how great and respected. That's why Motown is so respected. Bruno Mars doing all this sampling. That's all Motown, man. That's all everything reinventing. Barry, Mr. Gordy back collecting checks, man. These legends ain't done records in 50 years. 50 years still relevant. Getting a check. That's what they taught me. Timeless music. So when you sit down and you 70, you getting a check because some cat over here wasn't even born is redoing your record. That's what they taught me. So these guys here, I came, they asked me to talk, and I don't mean everybody's adults, but I'm telling y'all the realness to come talk to y'all about how this game really works and how you should move in this game and the work ethic you have to put and make sure you take care of these dudes. You ain't gonna meet dudes like this in the industry that's gonna be like, man, come this, man, I'll open up this house for you. You ain't gotta pay nothing. You ain't gotta do nothing. Just put your work in. Just and listen to them. You know what I mean? Their ears, you might not agree with them, but they trying to see you go, because if you go, they go. If you don't go, nobody. You gotta remember the talent makes the thing right. If the talent don't go, ain't nobody eat nothing. Like all the teams around me, if I don't do nothing, they can't do, managers and people like that can't do their job. But if you put in the work, you go and you pushing, their opportunities comes because one crack opens, they can negotiate, they can go here. So don't get here and get discovered by something and go somewhere and then turn your back and be all funny and be like, oh, they over here because I got this shot with Diddy over here. No, you take them too and you say, Diddy, these two was here for me right here. They come with me or not. You do right, straight business, we going to do it like that. If Diddy say no, you walk out that door. Because if you talented, Diddy going to call you. Don't think it, because you'll go right down over here to Cash Money or somebody else, and they'll be flipping there. But you don't leave them back there. But that's what we do. We go, oh, man, I got you. I got you. Don't play them games. Be on integrity. That's what Motown had. They had camaraderie. All of them had it. Stevie had camaraderie for Michael. Michael had camaraderie. That's why they all legends. Think about it. It's the only label in the world right now that everybody in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Everybody that's on Def Jam and all this shit, ain't nobody ever gonna be in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. You lucky if you get into Ohio. You lucky if you get there. All the Motown legends from Smokey and the Miracles down to the Jacksons and all in between is in Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. So because they had camaraderie and they worked together to help each other. They didn't do this stuff just to be, I'm going to get over her. She more talented than me or he more talented. It was like, no, we coming in. He talented. We're going to sing on your record. We're going to sing on your record. Listen to the Motown records. They all singing on each other's stuff. Marvin Gaye on this stuff. You know, this person on this stuff because they all won. And at the end of the day, they all got money. They all getting the states and royalty checks and living good. Think about it. When the last time Stevie Wonder, what's the newest record Stevie Wonder done put out? You can't even know, because the dude can go do 20,000 people and redo all his records and kids that wasn't even alive. Everybody's singing the hook. Any country, because they make timeless music. And that's what we got. A lot of y'all black in here. That's what we got to do in this urban game. Bring that stuff back, man. Y'all got a family here, man. Y'all got a family. If y'all work together with the way these two is, some noise is going to be made. I'm telling you, if y'all think that some noise is going to be made, you just got to make sure to take care of them. and don't turn your back on. So this is me, you know what I mean? And they're going to always be able to get in touch with me through Luke, through my management. I know I move a lot and be doing stuff, but I'm here to, you know, to encourage y'all to keep going, man. This is how the real music game is. This, you know, I use my life and my story because I had, you know, one of the most unique stories. You know, they sit me down to do a book and do a show on it because it was just so many ways. But I didn't, at the end of the day, I didn't ever give up. And that's what y'all should do. You know what I'm saying? That's, y'all never give up. You know, if you get your chance to be on a feature and it's only 4 bars and that feature is hot with somebody big, do the 4 bars. Don't come in there going, man, I got to do 8. I got to do 16. I've seen it. People spoil deals like that. Well, I ain't going to do 16. Why do 4? Because you know, if them 4 hot, that stuff turned to a whole song. You know what I'm saying? You can say, if I'm featured with Drake and I got 4 bars, do the 4 bars. You see what I'm saying? Get the 4 bars done. Don't be trying to come in there and go 8 and have them go negotiate. Be like, who are you? Do them 4 bars and make that joker hot to where them 4 bars, they be like, yo, that hot, and you on the song. Now you in the game. Now you leverage other stuff. But it's just, the thing about it, it's hard to get in the game. So you got to work hard. It's just hard to get that foot. It takes millions of dollars, you guys. I know, because it's into me and I made money, millions of dollars. It takes money to make that stuff go. So you got to get somebody to go, okay, I love this group. I'm going to put up millions of dollars for this person to be all over the place. Don't think Chance the Rapper and all these people you see. It's money behind cats. Somebody in the back is paying something. This music business is not a free business. Somebody is paying something. You just don't get on the big stage of a Grammys and nobody spent nothing. Somebody spent something. So you got to know this, but if you work as a unit, and whoever gets that shot, y'all push who gets that first shot. You guys as a team, he or her needs that push. Y'all push that first person. Because if y'all push that first person and he pop, y'all gone. Everybody's gone. Everybody's in the game. But if y'all don't push that first person, trust me, ain't nobody in the game. Because it's a hard game to get in. With all the social media too, everybody think they Instagram and all, you know how it is. Everybody think they hot right now and doing this. Every sending stuff over SoundCloud. Everything's oversaturated. So you really gotta have somebody have the niche. That's why I came in playing this, had the military. It made me separate because when I could go to rap, I could play. I could play and play instruments and stuff. I didn't have to just depend on the rap. So it paid off to me. So it got me in a different way. You notice Snoop, I played here. That led to me going, I wasn't rapping, I was producing. Then Snoop was like, you need to rap. It led me, but I was already producing and playing. And I could play instruments, so I still would be in the game. If they would say, hey, B, we just need you to play the keys. I'm getting a check, because I can play the keys. Hey, B, we need you to play the drums. I'm getting a check, but I'm in the building. And then once they start hearing and knowing my whole thing, it was like, whoa. So get in the building. I don't care if you have to freaking go give some water to Jay-Z. Get in the building because you come in there every freaking day giving him water. And it's going to be a time where you're going to have to open and to play your stuff. And if you prepared and you play your stuff after they be like, yo, after you know them for a while, can you play? And that stuff hot. You've been giving me water all this time. The respect is so different for you than if you come in and they're like, man, I got to give Jay-Z water. You better give him water because he's going to open up the studio for you to do what you got to do. So you got to have your game plan. It's like, if I got to go this way, I still know my game plan. If I got to go through the window, see, everybody try to come through the door. It's saturated. We can't all get through the same door. But if I can come through that crack over there, I'm coming, dude. I'm coming, right? Roaches don't come through. They come through all kind of, they don't give shit what it is. So it's like, be a roach. If you come in the hole, come in. Ants, they don't care. They come, ants come wherever. That's how you have to be in this game. You have to be like an ant. Wherever my hole is, wherever that opening, I'm in. Because everybody could talk about you, be like, oh, he over there, he don't know what you in. They could talk, everybody talking, oh, that man, he over there. But then they steadily seeing you. You steadily seeing you. You know what I'm saying? So just get in. They're going to talk. Oh, man, he ain't doing nothing. He ain't even out yet. But he's on the squad. It's one thing, yeah, he might not be on the basketball team, but he on the squad. It's 12 people. He's one of the 12 in the NBA. You could talk all of them, dude, sorry. His check compared to your check. Do the two. His plugs and pool compared to your pool. So don't worry about what people say, because I knew when I first got in, it was like, oh, B ain't putting. Now it's like everybody need jobs. Everybody that was talking need jobs and stuff. Can you help me out? Can I get security? Can I do, you know what I mean? All that stuff. So be like an ant, be like, get in, just get your little foot in the crack. And whoever out this team get their foot in the crack, y'all help the dude get through. It's like what we did in military as a team doing war. Push, Push, man. Don't care who it is. Just push, because we all, if the door open, we just all fall in the thing. That's how it's got to be. Don't be hating on nobody. Y'all know who the talented one is. Y'all know who the ones y'all need to push. We all, it's like basketball. You know who's shooting the J's. You know who balling like Jordan and LeBron. You know, you ain't got to tell nobody. Everybody can see. Everybody know who's in this room, who is the one to open up the door. You need to push that person. Push that person, and you better yourself while you push that person. Don't mean push them and don't work on your craft. Just push that person and hone your craft. Then when you go, trust me, it's going to be a good feeling. But don't cut the person down that you push. Don't, please don't. When he gets in there, don't cut the person down. Make that dude so he be a star, because it's easy to elevate everybody when you up here. But when you down here, it's harder to pull. And that's what we don't do as artists. So, you know, that's my story to y'all, you know what I mean? And y'all keep grinding and doing everything. So that's my story to y'all, man. You know? Cool. Cool. You're welcome.